her, barbarian or Greek murderer, Medea's gift of clothing and identity in Euripides' Medea. First of all, a tiny plot summary, just in case not everyone knows the story well. Euripides' Medea is the story of the barbarian princess Medea, who helped the hero Jason steal the golden fleece before going back to Corinth with him. In the play, he abandons her to marry the princess, Glauce. Medea takes her revenge on him by killing the princess with a magical bow and stabbing the children she bore Jason before leaving for Athens, where the king has promised her refuge. In Euripides' Medea, the robe and headband which the barbarian sorceress Medea sends as a gift of supplication to Glauce, the Corinthian princess, are some of the few props from which the text explicitly calls. While these items only appear on stage once, they are far more important than such a brief appearance suggests. Medea is conventionally presented as wearing distinctively barbarian clothing, as we can see here on a very famous depiction of her. She's in the center of the chariot, which is a calyx crater from Magna Graecia from around 400 BC. But her gift of clothing is so ambiguously described that it is possible that the gift could be presented on stage as either Greek or barbarian. Euripides' ambiguous descriptions of the garment's beauty, when combined with evidence from vase paintings, make a Greek presentation likely. This, however, is contradicted by the fact that his imprecise descriptions are similar to his other depictions of barbarity, and the clothing's origins make a barbarian presentation probable. In either case, focusing on the costuming choices can nuance Medea's and Glauce's complex relationships, both with each other and with their society, beyond what is provided by the text alone. The Greek style of the garment characterizes Medea not only as a witch, but also as a barbarian able to expropriate Greek culture, while the barbarian portrays Medea as desiring barbarian independence. Clothing is a powerful symbol for presenting one's identity. But this is particularly true in theater, where the audience is keenly aware that each aspect of the performance and production has been consciously chosen for an effect. Particularly in Medea, a play so concerned with ethnic and civic identity, costuming is an important way of distinguishing between these identities. The robes and headdress which Medea sends to Glauce are rich and beautiful, but it is possible that they are otherwise garments such as any upper-class Greek woman might have worn. The terminology used, however, is too imprecise to be certain about their culture of origin. Medea calls the dress a peplos, a word simply meaning any woven cloth, and the headdress a plokos, or a wreath, and the chorus calls the latter an anadesme, or a band for a woman's hair. The text's ambiguity makes it possible that these garments were, in fact, not Eastern, but Greek. Thus, a barbarian woman, who is the antithesis of a well-behaved Greek woman, gives clothing whose production the Greeks strongly associated with Greek womanhood. Since Medea is an Athenian play, this paper focuses on the customs for Athenian women. They were kept inside, not given much education, and expected to be submissive, obedient, and extremely modest. This extreme seclusion and suppression of women became a mark of upper-class respectability and privilege. As a princess, this is the life and behavior that would be expected of Glauce. Indeed, she is presented as a perfect example of this ideal Athenian woman, seeing as she does not appear or speak in the play, and is reported to be obedient both to her father and her husband. Medea, on the other hand, is active, vocal, and has no male protector, and thus is the antithesis of the ideal woman. The garments might also be Greek because Euripides gives them very high aesthetic value, calling them delicate, golden, and having loveliness and divine brightness. The Greeks considered themselves, their art, and their culture superior to all the surrounding cultures, and so it seems surprising that Euripides would give such extravagant praise to non-Greek clothing. As noted earlier, Glauce conforms to the behavior of a well-brought-up Greek girl. Thus, it is surprising that she would be willing to put on a garment that she would view as barbarian, and therefore is ugly. Euripides' Medea is much too clever and much too determined to exact her revenge, to risk that her garment, that her gift be rejected by giving one that the recipient would disdain. In this way, it is logical that she would disguise her murderous apparel as an ordinary and therefore a harmless piece of Greek woman's clothing. Showing a seemingly innocent Greek-style dress and wreath in the scene when Medea sends her children to Glauce, would later add considerable surprise and dramatic power to the messenger's speech announcing Glauce's death. Since the production details of the City of Dionysia performances do not survive, it is impossible to know what the costume design was. What visual evidence does survive, however, is in the form of vases depicting scenes from the story of Medea, specifically the European version where she kills her children. These vases are mostly from Magna Graecia and approximately date to a century after the debut of Euripides' play in 431 BCE. But several examples appear to be theatrical and are likely modeled after either local productions or reports of Athenian productions. Even if they were modeled after local productions, it is possible that these productions were inspired by Athenian originals. No matter the exact circumstances of their production, these vases demonstrate how Greeks depicted Medea and so can be useful evidence for tragic productions. Many of these vases show Medea in a distinctively barbarian costume, as we saw in the earlier vase and also appears on this vase. These include a volucrater here, which is painted with various scenes from the tale. The central scene, and here's a detail of it, is an old man standing in a nondescript temple-like building, looking upset over a young woman who is slumped on a throne right there. Presumably, this is Creon discovering Glauce's death. This surviving image of the murderous garments, possibly inspired by theatrical performances, is the best indication of the Greek view of this scene and its costuming. Here, Glauce's dress is simply draped fabric and a necklace without anything that would mark it as non-Greek. And in fact, it looks very similar to those of other Greek women also on this vase. This vase, therefore, shows Medea giving Glauce a Greek-style gift, which she uses to appropriate Greek culture and manipulate her identity as a barbarian woman against the Greek and male identity dominating Corinth. Medea is definitively barbarian, yet she gives Greek garments, which are a prominent sign of Greek womanhood, to Glauce. This is all the more remarkable because, as mentioned earlier, the play heavily emphasizes their beauty and craftsmanship. Medea has obtained, from her barbarian family, Greek-style clothing so beautiful that it tempts a princess, who surely has many rich and beautiful objects. In this way, seemingly safe, beautiful Greek objects become associated with a dangerous barbarian sorceress who refuses to comply with the wishes of the men around her. Even worse, her pseudo-Greek clothes are even better than the Greek garments of the Corinthians themselves. Through her gift of clothing, Medea becomes even more menacing by threatening ideas of Greek superiority. She becomes a barbarian who can adopt Greek culture and perform it better than the Greeks themselves. For the Athenian audience, the suggestion that their superiority was not absolute, but could be imitated and improved upon by a barbarian would be terrifying. Medea's gift of the clothing, then, continues the portrayal of her capability to use the traits associated with the dominant elements of her society to manipulate her own marginalized identity as both a woman and a foreigner. From the beginning of the play, Medea is characterized as a defiant and wronged woman whom the nurse compares to an unbending wave, rock, or a wave of the sea, a common comparison denoting stubbornness in Greek poetry, because she has been dishonored by Jason. She is entirely unsubmissive and utterly unlike the Greek ideal of a modest, quiet woman as she calls down curses upon Jason and his new bride, saying, "May I one day see him and his bride pounded to nothing, house and all." However, while talking to Jason just before she gives the gifts to the children, whom she sends as suppliants to Glauce, Medea acts with stereotypical feminine passivity and foolishness. She shows that while she rejects a woman's socially privileged, she fully understands it and is able to play the part when it is to her advantage. Yet at the same time, She acts like a man concerned about political strategies and the establishment of a dynasty, displaying a convergence of masculine and feminine attributes, which is typical of the characterization of barbarians in Greek tragedy. She says, "It is most advantageous to us in marrying a princess and producing brothers for my children." But she models this political man on Jason, whom she calls a man who is no man. Thus, he too is drawn into Medea's manipulation of both the conceptions of masculinity and femininity, but also of Greek and barbarian identities and modes of behavior. This manipulation of gender roles continues as Medea sends the children away with the gifts. Here, she takes on a powerful male role, such as a warrior or a ruler, by performing the actions of a powerful man and calling her children up, announcing a treaty or a truce, and having the children take their father's right hand. Contradicting her manly behavior, however, she gives a gift of fabric, of clothing, which is not only considered a feminine concern, but its creation was even one of women's key duties. Through her gift, Medea is seen to manipulate the gender roles Corinthian society expects, continuing her characterization as a dangerous barbarian due to this non-conformity to Greek values for women. By giving the Greek clothing, Medea adds another aspect to this manipulation of identities. She stands on stage, herself dressed distinctively as a barbarian, and acting in a masculine manner while being a woman and sending Greek gifts. By acting as a submissive Greek woman while talking to Jason, but as a strong Greek leader when talking to her children, and also giving foreign dangerous gifts disguised as Greek presents, Medea flaunts her barbarous threat to Greek propriety and order in front of the audience. Yet she conceals it from her fellow characters, imagining to be simultaneously both Greek and barbarian, and thus reveals her ability to manipulate people so that they allow her what she requires to achieve her goals. On stage, only the chorus understands that Medea's innocence is an act and murder will follow. Due, however, to the ambiguity of Euripides' descriptions of the clothes, it is also possible that the clothing is, in fact, distinctively non-Greek. This costuming choice would considerably simplify Medea's characterization and make her more consistently barbarian and lessen the quasi-Greekness that is disturbing to the audience. Yet, this would not make the play as a whole any less troubling to Athenians. Instead, Glauke, supposedly a well-behaved, well-raised Greek girl, accepts the foreign gift. She eagerly dresses herself in it, and by taking on the symbols of a barbarian, she partially becomes one herself. As in theater, where costume is symbolic of core identity, putting on a foreign dress is essentially no different from becoming a foreigner. Because they have seen the garment, the audience would imagine a woman who looks like a barbarian when the messenger describes Glauke putting it on. In fact, the messenger says that Glauke was utterly thrilled by the gifts and greatly admired her image in them, looking at herself in a shining mirror and admiring the way the robe fell. Thus, being like, or at least looking like the barbarian Medea is attractive. In many ways, it is actually more logical for the garments to be foreign, since Medea explicitly says that they are objects which the father of my father gave to his children. Medea's origins in Colchis, a strange, far-off land of legends and quests, are emphasized along with her ancestry from Aeetes and Helios. In fact, Medea begins with the nurse recalling Medea's distant origins and the long voyage that Jason took to get to Colchis, and the one in reverse that they both took. Corinth. Throughout the rest of the play, the characters repeatedly reference Medea's foreignness. For Medea to have brought Greek garments, which she inherited from her foreign ancestors in her foreign homeland, is nonsensical. From their mythological providence, then, there is a convincing case that the garments may be foreign. In her study, Barbarians in Greek Tragedy, Bacon notes that unlike Aeschylus and Sophocles, Euripides is not interested in the specifics of how barbarians differ from Greeks, but only in their symbolic foreignness, and thus does not concentrate on the details of the differences of barbarian dress, customs, geography, etc. She notes that Euripides instead focuses on the luxury of foreign garments, which is exactly the circumstance of Medea, such as when the wreath is described as chrysolaton, of beaten gold. And the characters repeatedly describe the gifts as golden, delicate, and finely woven, all indicative of luxury and splendor. Which, following from Bacon, is enough in Euripides to characterize the garments as decidedly non-Greek. Hall agrees that delicate is a word particularly associated with barbarity in Greek tragedy, when it is accompanied by other indications of barbarism, as it certainly is in Medea. Greeks typically saw barbarians and their accoutrements as dangerous and transgressive, and this is heightened in the stage setting, where symbolism is far more prominent than in day-to-day life. Yet Glauce accepts and immediately puts on a barbarian gift from a woman who is not only a barbarian, but also her husband's abandoned first wife. So the question is, why would Glauce want the clothing? The most straightforward reading is that which is in line with female stereotypes, namely that she simply desires rich and beautiful things. But this is oddly shallow for an author who creates psychologically complex characters such as Phaedra, Hippolytus, and Pentheus. Examining how Glauce fits into the city as a whole can help to create a more nuanced picture of her. Glauce is presented as the opposite of Medea. She is the girl who obeys her father, unlike Medea, who abandons her birth family, and marries the man she was instructed to, while Medea left Colchis with Jason, against her father's wishes. She is entirely controlled by her father. Yet the other women of Corinth, as represented by the chorus of Corinthian women, who, like Glauce, were born and raised in Corinth, are deeply aware of how restrictive their society is for women. Somewhat unusually for Greek tragedy, the chorus is of women, not of old men, which results in a play that is dominated by female voices supporting Medea. They say that Medea is a victim of injustice, that she would be right to exact vengeance from her husband. They respond to Medea's threats against Jason by saying that they shall be celebrated, honor is coming to the female sex. And most powerfully, they tell Medea when at her lowest point, alas, alas, you pitiful woman, wretched in your sufferings, wherever can you turn? Where can you find a host to welcome you? What home, what country to shield you from disaster? For the god has brought you, Medea, to an overwhelming sea of woes. These words would not sound out of place for Medea herself. If all these women, presumably Glauce's neighbors and friends, have this knowledge and distress about their place in society, how can she be so completely ready to accept submission to her father? Through her barbarity and her herbal and magical lore, Medea has agency to influence the world she lives in, the people around her, and potential independence from the narrow confines of a Corinthian woman's life, which is realized when she flies off at the end of the play. Confused gender roles make up a key part of barbarity to the Greeks, which gives Medea the ability to pursue her own desires and revenge like a man. Barbarity in this play amounts to freedom from the confining gender roles of Greek society. Barbaric opposition to patriarchy imbues the gift she gives to Jason's new bride as much as the poison that Glauce is unaware of does. Glauce's eager acceptance of the gifts onto her own body demonstrate the barbarity and the power and independence of a barbarian woman, as embodied in the garment, has a degree of desirability to a Greek woman. In some sense, then, Glauce wants to become Medea, hoping that her power will transfer onto the wearer of her clothing. Glauce, of course, has another reason to wish to be like or become Medea. Her new husband, Jason, married her for political expediency, but he seems to have married Medea for love, since he took her back to Corinth with him, although he could have forgotten her on a remote island, just as Theseus did with Ariadne, once she had outlived her use. Perhaps Glauce hoped that if she were dressed like Medea, and therefore took on some of her essence, Jason might love her, too. This is not the only example of a poisoned robe being used as a love charm in Greek tragedy. In Sophocles' Women of Trachis, Deianira attempts to use a robe imbued with Nessus' blood and Hydra poison to regain Hercules' love due to her jealousy over his foreign mistress. However, the robe kills Heracles instead, clinging to him and tearing at his bones. Now, given the Women of Trachis precedent, Glauce's interpretation of Medea's gift as a love charm might be available to the audience for consideration. Medea and Glaucon not only have a close connection due to the desires for both Jason and barbarian independence, as displayed in their interactions over the gift, but they are also connected by the chorus and by literary history. First, the chorus has an affiliation with Medea through their sympathy for her situation as a woman abandoned by her husband and the conventions of Greek tragedy, which dictate that the chorus generally supports the lead character. However, as Corinthians, they also would have a civic identity-based affiliation with Glaucon. Both figures are closely associated with this mass of Corinthian women and are thereby easily associated with each other because of this. Secondly, an earlier poet, Eumelus, from around 740 BCE, wrote in his Corinthiaca that Aetes, Helios' son, was the king of Corinth, but then left it to go to Colchis. This gives Medea Corinthian, not barbarian origins, identifying her yet more closely with Glaucon. In fact, in Eumelus' version, Medea plays the role that Glaucon plays here, the princess whom Jason marries to legitimize his rule. At least some of the audience must have been aware of this prior tradition, and so they would be more likely to see the connections between Medea of the Corinthiaca and Glaucon of the Medea. This literary history also gives Medea more reason to murder Glaucon, who is usurping Medea's role, both as Jason's wife and her older role as Princess of Corinth and a political bride. Thus, even if Medea's gift is barbarian, she inescapably retains an element of Greekness. In the Medea, Euripides describes the garments Medea gives to Glaucon in such ambiguous terms that they can be either Greek or barbarian. When their beauty is connected with the Greeks, opinion of their cultural superiority and a depiction of Glaucon's death on a Napoleon vase, this amounts to good evidence for a Greek depiction. Such a depiction would allow Medea to use it to manipulate and blur identities as is typical of barbarians in Greek tragedy, while she manipulates the people around her. Because the garments may be foreign, the portrayal of Glaucon as an ideal Greek girl is complicated due to their status as Medea's family heirlooms and their description as delicate and luxurious. Glaucon's actions, namely wearing the garments despite their perception as dangerous items, suggest that, like the other women in the play, she wants both freedom and power, and therefore wants to become like Medea, with some measure of both. This desire is increased by the possibility that the dress can serve as a love charm by making Jason see her as Medea, whom he seemingly loved. Connections between Medea and Glaucon, therefore, are not surprising, seeing that the chorus identifies with both of them, in addition to the earlier versions in which Medea's occupied Glaucon's role as the Corinthian princess. Thus, considering the stage of ancient productions opens up unusual ways of analyzing the play, as well as being informative for modern productions of ancient tragedy. Thank you. Questions, comments?
Matt? Yeah, thanks, I like that. Do you think, so like, So there's that weird part where, like, Aegisthus comes and offers Medea refuge in Athens, mm-hmm. and sort of, so I wonder if you think, like, Euripides is sort of critiquing the contemporary wars and sort of implying that Athenian women are losing their, you know, their modesty or something like that, and that Athens is becoming this safe harbor for loose women or for free women, and like sort of the idea of Jason's new wife, like I like the idea that she's like happily taking these gifts and sort of like embracing this un-Athenian female freedom in a way, and so I wonder if you think that's like a subtext of the play as well.
I haven't really thought about that particular aspect of it. I can definitely see that. I think another interesting thing to consider is that Athens and Corinth don't always get along very well, so Athenians are probably quite happy to watch Corinthian society fall apart a bit and be destroyed a bit. then it is very interesting that you have the Athenian king welcoming Medea, who is so obviously dangerous and antithetical to Greek propriety, to Athens. And I think that's another angle on this that I don't really have that much on right now that would get me interesting to consider in relation to this paper.
Relatively early on in the play, like there, the Corinthian women do seem to sympathize a great deal with Medea, but later on I seem to remember that they do, I mean, she gets them to promise to be silent early on in the play, and they do turn on her a bit in their sympathies later on. I'm just wondering what you make of that regarding the play's perspective on barbarians and women, that they seem to regret their sympathy almost.
Well, that it's impossible that they can feel some sympathy and connection with Medea, but also disapprove of her actions. You know, they have this connection to both Medea and to Glauce, and so they're put in a really, and also, you know, they're people who presumably don't think that murdering children is a great idea. So they're put in this really awkward position because they were like, yeah, Medea, you're right, this sucks for you. But then, she starts doing things and they go, this isn't what we meant by you can take your revenge. This is awful. So, you know, the chorus doesn't necessarily have to remain completely of the same opinion through the whole play. And they can also hold multiple